of the k pi 1 space. So we'll be most interested in equivalence of categories as opposed to isomorphism of categories. But nevertheless, let me make one comment about that. If we also remember the subspace of zero simplices, so think of temporarily, think of BC as something that spits out a space with a subset, then we can reconstruct the category up to isomorphism just by taking by construction, this canonical functor does not hit all objects in pi 1 of BC, it only hits those that live in this subspace. In the notes, I wrote this as pi 1 BC, comma n 0 C. And this just means the full subcategory of the fundamental groupoid. Full subcategory on objects. So objects are points, and I only take the points in N0C. So it lands there by definition, and the same proposition shows that this will be an isomorphism of categories if C is a groupoid. So, okay, and this thing is then an equivalence, that inclusion. If, okay, more interestingly, if it's not a groupoid, then you still have this natural transformation from C to a groupoid. And the statement in that case is that if C is not a groupoid, by which I mean not necessarily a groupoid, I still have this functor. From the original category to the fundamental groupoid of the classifying space, let's say it hits only the subcategory on the objects here. But that's equivalent to the full fundamental groupoid. I still have this functor. And it, in that case, is the universal functor from C to a groupoid. So that's is the universal functor from C to a groupoid. Say what that means. It can mean two things. But so given any, given a small groupoid D and a functor C to D. If I have a functor from C to a groupoid, then there's a unique factorization like this through a functor. Okay, if you have to say it that way, it's important I remember this. Otherwise, I would have to say something unique up to isomorphism of functors, but here I mean, this is a correct statement. This is a unique functor. So, anyway, I mean, that's a statement you have to prove. No, that was the comment I just made. I mean, this is one correct statement you can make. But there's another one. I mean, the problem with this is that it's a universal property of this thing up to isomorphism of categories. Like, it's not a... Okay. This is a universal property for this one, but not for this equivalent category. There's another statement you can make where you say something up to equivalence, but... right. So, let me say a few words about it. Let's see. Probably have time for that. So these have the same objects. Let's see. What do I want to say? Okay, so first of all, let me say this is a true statement. So because it's a universal property, it characterizes this pair of this groupoid, the fundamental groupoid of the classifying space, the full subcategory on points in N0, together with this functor, characterizes this up to unique isomorphism of categories. As any universal property. If you don't like characterizing categories up to isomorphism, then you can find another universal property that characterizes it up to equivalence of categories, but I think this is maybe a simpler statement. The proof is kind of easy. First of all, these two have the same object set. This is a bijection on objects, object sets. So certainly this thing is like uniquely given on objects. Just do whatever you do there. On morphisms, uniqueness on morphisms. So what do morphisms in the fundamental groupoid of the classifying space look like? Well, they're passed from interval into BC. Say 0 goes to X, that's some object. 1 goes to Y, that's some other object. Then, up to homotopy real endpoints, I can make this path, I can homotopy it into the one skeleton. Up to homotopy is a concatenation of paths in the one skeleton, but the one skeleton are precisely the morphisms in C. up to homotopy and the one skeleton are, another way of saying that is, so morphism in C is regarded as a path, is like gamma of that morphism. Except I might run some of those in the opposite direction. So So morphisms have a direction, but paths can go in the kind of wrong direction. So gamma of F1 to the plus minus 1 composed with gamma of F2 to the plus minus 1, and so on. So homotoping a path into the one skeleton writes an arbitrary path as a concatenation of things that come from here and their inverses. But then if this is supposed to be a functor and this is a groupoid, it must send, and the diagram is supposed to commute, gamma of F must go to capital, so if I have an F in C, say, X comma Y, this goes to F of F. So gamma of F must go to F of F, but gamma of F inverse must also go to F of F inverse, which makes sense because D is a groupoid. So since any morphism is here, is a composition of things of this form, there's at most one option here, and then you have to check that that works. Okay, so, right. So that characterizes this one uniquely up to isomorphism, and therefore this one up to equivalence of categories by a universal property. In the notes and in the problems this afternoon, there's some examples of what happens in this to specific specific examples. This construction has a name, I mean this universal property. It's called the localization of this category. Localization of categories. There's a general construction that starts with a small category and a subset of the morphism set. And produces a category denoted C brackets W inverse together with a functor from C, which is a bijection on object sets, sends morphism in W to isomorphisms, and is unique, sorry, is a universal with that property. If you have any functor from C into an arbitrary small category that sends morphisms in W to isomorphisms, then it factors uniquely through this one. Okay, such a thing exists, and therefore characterizes this again up to unique isomorphism of categories. Okay, you have to prove existence, of course, but that's not too difficult. In that notation, what we've done is the special case where W is all morphisms. So this could be W is equal to all morphisms of C. And then we get the universal functor from C into a groupoid in this notation. Can be written this way. So in some, I mean, with that notation, the calculation is that the fundamental groupoid of BC, full subcategory and these things, is a particular model for this localization of categories. So i.e., to continue the statement, one BC and zero C. Good. So that's a kind of concise statement about how much can be reconstructed of a category from the fundamental groupoid. It's precisely the localization at the set of all morphisms. Okay, I have 10 minutes left. Let me say a little bit more. Let me say a few kind of corollaries. If you don't know C but only know BC, you still know this localization up to equivalence of categories, and therefore you know what functors C has into groupoids. D is a groupoid. Fun C, comma D. This is the same thing as fun C, C inverse D. It's then the same thing as, and that's what the universal property says, fun pi 1 BC N0 C D. This is up to isomorphism of functor categories. And finally, the last step, if I only know the fundamental groupoid. So this is the functor category. So two functors, I mean, functor category has object functors and morphisms, natural transformations. The last one is an equivalence, and the other ones are isomorphisms. And maybe in practice you kind of want to maybe in practice you want to work up to equivalence, but so if you know BC up to equivalence of categories, you know what functors C have into groupoids. Just rephrasing what I just said. So maybe I can now make a preliminary definition of field theory. I don't really know what an actual field theory is. I mean, I think the one I consider the actual definition is probably also preliminary from a more fancy point of view. So so in the notes I call this a poor man's field theory. I don't think this notion is actually useful for very much, but but it's kind of a toy example of the definition I'll talk about later. So if D is a small category, then the poor man's version of a field theory is just a functor from cob D into D. And the only field theory aspect of this is that I call it Z. So this would be a devalued maybe D minus 1 comma D theory, because this category involves manifolds of dimension D minus 1 and D only. What I consider the actual definition, but which I'm sure is also extremely preliminary, you would have to say something about a symmetric monoidal functor. Okay. I don't have very much intelligence to say about field theories in that generality, but so field theory is invertible. (Clears throat) if it takes any morphism to an isomorphism, that's the property it could have. For example, if D is a groupoid, so if Z of any morphism, Z of F is use this notation D with a tilde. So this has the same objects, but only the isomorphisms. It's a subcategory of D. It sends all cobordisms to isomorphisms in D. So you might as well just forget about D and only work with D tilde and then rename it D. So you, so say an invertible field theory is one whose target category is a groupoid. Again, very preliminary definition. To classify invertible field theories by this general discussion about small categories, it suffices to understand the homotopy type of the classifying space of Cobd. Classification of invertible field theories. Suffices to understand homotopy type of the classifying space of Cobd. This version of the definition, I mean, D is just an ordinary category, maybe groupoid. So we don't want don't even need quite the whole homotopy type, since what we're going to do is take the fundamental groupoid. So this suffices, as I said. It actually suffices to find a space X and a two connected map from X into B cob D. Well, suffices. What I'm implicitly saying is that you want to find a space X that you understand better than B cob D, and then maybe you have some argument that this is too connected. Then you just take the fundamental groupoid of this one instead. Too connected means, okay, maybe you know that, means bijection on set of path components and isomorphism on fundamental groups with any base point, surjection on pi 2 with any base point, and no further conditions. Even forgetting the surjection on pi 2, that's still sufficient to say equivalence of fundamental groupoids. So this implies pi 1 x to pi 1 b cob d is an equivalence of categories. Okay, so that's what I'm going to do in the lecture tomorrow. I mean, explain what this X is going to be and state the sense in which we understand there's going to be an X where we in some sense understand the whole homotopy type of X in a way that we in practice can work out what the fundamental groupoid is. And then we've classified invertible field theories in this poor man's version, at least. let's see. Lecture 3, I'll talk a bit about, I mean, removing some of this. Lecture 3, I'm going to talk a little bit about symmetric monoidal structures. And then change this definition to say something like symmetric monoidal functions. The answer doesn't change very much. I mean, you still have to understand the homotopy type of this thing, just have to understand it as a space with more structure. That kind of mirrors the extra structure that we put on COPD. So even though this is kind of a toy version of the question, it's sort of quite close to the question I'll talk about on Wednesday. Let me see, was there more I wanted to say? No, let me stop here. Yes, let me repeat the question. This is an unoriented, or it was not a question, it was a statement, but just repeating it and agreeing. This is an unoriented field theory because the manifolds are just kind of naked manifolds with no further structure. I'll briefly mention that. I mean, I put it in the notes at least. You can put other structure like an orientation, a spin structure, and so on. The general, or the level of generality I took was that you can put any tangential structure. On the manifolds, by which I mean an equivariant map from the frame bundle into some specified space that I call capital theta. That's a GLDR equivariant map. So whenever you have a space with an action of GLDR, you can go back and change the definition and put this sort of structure on all the manifolds inside. And then you get a new cobordism category. For example, if this space is like plus minus one and the action is by the sign of the determinant, then an equivariant map is the same thing as an orientation. But everything I say will have versions in this generality. It just takes longer to state, and there's not a whole... On the level of ideas, there are no kind of new ideas, but... it includes Riemannian metrics. This could be, right. All the non-trivial things I have to say are homotopy invariant in theta, and up to equivariant. I mean, Riemannian metrics is sort of a contractible choice, so the statements I'm going to make, Riemannian metrics, you might as well not have any structure, because it's a contractible structure, but yeah.